10 minutes of quality talk between mother and husband.
Yes.
And with the Krishna and the Guru in the center, what does it mean in the, can you give an example?
Yeah, as I said, I was giving my own example. My reflection on, like, when I'm expressing my gratitude, that thank you for giving me the support because of which I'm able to go to the university. Why am I going to the university? To please my spiritual master. Right? So how to basically see very clearly how the wife is assisting my services to my spiritual master. And similarly, the wife is saying how my husband is assisting me in my service to my spiritual master. And Krishna, naturally. So that thought should be there. It's otherwise it's just an exploitative relationship, right? If that focus is not there, then it's an exploitation. Then it's just, okay, I'm just going to keep counting. Exploitation means you will start counting. You have done this, you have washed dishes 5 times. I have done it 10 times. Slowly things will start coming into picture. So love means that there is no score giving. It's more focused on mutual appreciation, understanding the value that is provided by that association in the household. So we should not forget that Krishna has provided a devotee right at home for my association. So let me make the best utilization of that. Krishna has provided association right at home. We should not complain, we do not have association. Right at home we have association. But we have to see that. And try to also see, when we are appreciating, our appreciation should be also genuine and should be specific that yes, I felt that, like, that because of your presence, my relationship with Guru and Krishna is growing. Because of your presence in my life, I feel that I am moving forward in my Krishna consciousness. And I thank you for that. And there will be specific instances of those thank yous. Does it answer? So it should be very specific to development of Krishna consciousness. Okay.
Hare Krishna. So what happens if husband and wife both are not on the same page of Krishna consciousness? One has different beliefs and one doesn't. So one is 100% focused on his consciousness and one is not 100%.
Okay.
So what happens now? I know that you did mention then that will be unsuccessful, but in what way?
I didn't say unsuccessful.
Okay, I must have heard. So can you just explain a little bit more on that?
Okay, good. So one thing is that, if let's say one of the persons, one of the spouses, is more advanced in Krishna consciousness. As I was answering to him, when the relationship is very intimate, either it's peer or senior, it's the best we can do is that we can set an example, very nice example, and when the qualities come out, and the person is able to appreciate Krishna consciousness through the appreciation of qualities that are exhibited by the practitioner of Krishna consciousness, then automatically one will feel inspired that there is something in his heart because of which, like, it is making my wife more and more, like, either efficient or more and more gentle or whatever different qualities that you can observe. She is now becoming more tolerant, more humble, more compassionate. So if you are able to relate to those qualities, let's say, I'm not making a judgment call here, I'm just taking an example here,
right?
That, like, suppose the wife is more advanced, then one can just see those qualities that, okay, the wife is now exhibiting these qualities. Where are those qualities coming from? These qualities are coming from our practice of Krishna consciousness. So there is something meaningful in that practice. So let me also try, so one can feel inspired that way. You see? So it's not a matter of, like, so if that gap exists, that within that gap also there could be intimacy, right? The wife can share how she is benefited by the process of Krishna consciousness. And wife and the husband can share his struggle, and vice versa. The wife can share her struggle and husband can express the different things that is actually working well for him. The point is that when we have that intimate time, we can use it in a way that we can assist each other in taking steps forward in Krishna consciousness. our way. If they are on the same pace, yes, then we can just go full bloom. If there is a difference in pace, okay, we just share what we are realizing. Now, because Krishna does not interfere with the free will, nobody is interfering with the free will of any living entity, but we can definitely create an inspiring environment. Understanding, like whatever little bit of glories that we have known so far, so at least we can bring out those glories. Does that help?
I was trying to listen, like, is it okay that one can get progress, more progress, and then he or she can go to back to the Godhead? But one can remain, right? Means it's free will. But is it that if both are not in the same phase, that she cannot develop herself or she cannot progress and she cannot go to Godhead?
In multiple cases, the success of our spiritual life is measured by the quality of one's relationship with one's spiritual master. So if one has got a very strong connection with a bona fide, able spiritual master, it cannot be hampered by any material circumstances, whatever that might be. So it's just a matter of developing a very strong relationship with a bona fide. That's all it matters. So if the husband is a very strong Krishna conscious devotee and wife is very strongly intimately related to the husband, just by serving her husband she can go back to Godhead. It's a very principle. And likewise, like if the relationship with the spiritual master is very strong, on that basis of connection, we are pulled out of our disqualifications and placed at the lotus feet of Krishna. And that's why the secret of success of spiritual life is our strength of relationship with our spiritual master. And nothing, no other visual impediments that can come this way, cannot come.
How to develop that strength?
Progressively. First we need to have a guru.
How do you know who is your guru?
First we show our sincerity to Krishna. And Krishna, seeing that sincerity, Krishna makes arrangement for whoever we are supposed to take inspiration from. But we must connect ourselves to a bona fide spiritual master. There is no way out other than that.
But first you have to give up yourself to Krishna, then Krishna will arrange the master.
So basically, like, we express our sincerity that I need a spiritual master. I cannot progress. Life is filled with perplexities. I cannot resolve those perplexities myself. I need someone to guide my life. When that internal need is there, Krishna will immediately send a spiritual master. Because everything in spiritual life is based on desire. First we have to fix our desires. The question is like whether we want to progress forward or not. That's why we boil down. If you want to progress forward, Krishna will make every arrangement possible for that. And that's Krishna's arrangement, that like when he sees there is a devotee who is sincere, who wants to progress genuinely in spiritual life, Krishna will send someone to pull that devotee and progress. That's how the process works. It's completely by divine arrangement. It's not by our own effort so much. Our effort is showing our sincerity. Some other proving our sincerity. I really want you, Krishna. And then rest, Krishna does.
Mind that this is a mode of goodness, where I had to do the night turn of cross thing on the sacrifices. Because it was said so.
One reason is we are conditioned. Condition means our conditions remain the same. Or we are prone to embrace the same set of conditions again and again. Without any cessation. That's the nature that we have built up over a period of time. So we have a tendency to just fall back into matter. That's a... So it's not necessarily that I do not have the sincere desire to follow. I want to follow, but at the same time, my senses are not fully controlled. Right? That means I have some more work to do in strengthening my relationship to my spiritual master to such an extent that I can be at the beck and call of the spiritual master. If you say that cut off your hands, you are ready to cut off. You see the point? It's basically a function of how strong the relationship has developed from our side. So once that is there, if we are capturing that, we would, and it is progressive, because relationship is also developed progressively. But you will find that the real thing that actually propels our Krishna consciousness is really the strength of that relationship, nothing else. If there is something else, it would not be sustainable.
The question about kind of dharma that's there, the wife's dharma is to serve the husband, but if the wife is more spiritual and the husband is more materialistic, what is the wife's dharma?
The prime example is Gandhari. So, wife's dharma now becomes definitely twofold. Patiently serving the husband, yet waiting for that opportunity for that transformation to happen, on the strength of the qualities that the wife is exhibiting on the basis of her Krishna consciousness. So, if the wife is really very strong in Krishna consciousness, then she will have that power. Krishna will give that power to transform the heart. If at all Krishna so desires, of course, then that can happen. But from the wife's perspective, it's a very challenging situation, very, very challenging situation. And therefore, the best that wife can do is really not allow that circumstance to affect the sadhana. The wife can still continue to move on. And at the same time, duty is not asked to execute. Not sure how they because why otherwise you get married in the first place? That's the question we have to ask. Otherwise, marriage means we wanted to fulfill the responsibilities. So now, after having married, we cannot question that, okay, now I have to do something services because why else would you get married? But it should not be that the only wife is serving the husband, it's the other way too. Husband is also serving the wife, like when the husband is coming from the office, sometimes like wife does not have that perspective, what kind of complicated environment that the husband is coming from. Because the office is a very contaminated place,
yeah,
like filled with passion.
Both of them are not doing anything wrong, but it's just a question about what is actual dharma of the wife versus the husband. A husband, he can go spiritually as long as he wants. The wife's dharma is only to follow. That's what I mean so far.
No, if the husband is demoniac, wife's responsibility is not to just follow the demoniac husband. Wife can still cultivate Krishna consciousness while serving the husband in various ways of the household, whatever the household is contributing. Idea is not to follow the husband. In fact, there is a very clear recommendation, just now we read, just now we quoted that verse. One should not become a husband, which means that the wife can reject the husband. Reject in the sense that one can reject following that kind of pattern.
that is there. Like Pali Maharaj, he did with his guru, Shukracharya. Why? Because Shukracharya told him, you should not actually offer to Vishnu. So, I'm just giving an example, I'm giving an extreme example here, that if one principle is that Guru Avagya, or to disobey the orders of the future master, it's a big, grievous sin. Right? But there is a clause that, okay, if the Guru is not actually qualifying himself by supporting the journey of Krishna consciousness, then that Guru can be rejected. Now, I am not proposing here for that kind of rejection, but I am just saying that one does not have to necessarily follow the ways of the husband if it is not Krishna conscious. The wife can still maintain her own Krishna consciousness and strengthen it, taking strength from Guru and Krishna again, and use that as a medium to transform the heart of the husband. That's the best way one can execute. It's a very complicated situation, but that's the best one can do in that situation. Right?
And about the divorce, now that everybody probably hears a divorce, more divorce cases than any as per the Dharma, whoever is the Dharmanipati, whether it's a wife or the husband, I mean, again, it's not a Dharma as a quality.
Yeah, I understand.
It's just a quality of the Dharma.
Yeah, sure.
You know, quality is coming in. And around the period of their life also, how the Navagrahas and all those work, I think something happens that they fight a lot and they get divorced. And this situation is increasing more and more these days, like whatever benefits how can, is there anything that ISKCON is going to preach?
Definitely. Like all this is about protecting a society from divorce. If one is very strong in Krishna consciousness, there is no question of divorce. What are the principles that we are discussing within the Krishna ashram, like building this framework of intimacy and respect? But once that is there, there is no question of divorce, right?
See, if they have little bit of Krishna consciousness, they will be driven towards your lectures to benefit from it. But if they are nowhere, if those couples, if they're not couples that have never heard of God or never practiced it or doesn't believe in that system, is there anything that can be done?
So you are asking a question, can Krishna consciousness help someone if they are not ready to accept Krishna consciousness?
Right.
So that's a moot question. Right? You are saying that okay, there is help available, and here is a person who is not ready to take the help. Can he still get that?
No, he might be an atheist. I mean, that couple might be an atheist, but still,
okay.
They might be good in other qualities, right? I mean, they might be loving, they might be having whatever
but
giving and all that, but they probably don't believe Krishna.
So Bhagavatam's perspective is on that, is that Yasyaste Bhakti Bhagavati Akinchana, Sarve Jana Sukhara, Arav Amaprasya, Tuto Mahatguram. Mano Rachana Asati Bhavati. What it says is that for a person who has developed love for Krishna, or one who is following the activities of Krishna consciousness with bhakti sincerity, automatically all the good qualities get decorated on that person. Okay? On the other hand, harav avaktasya, if one is disconnected to one, connecting one from Hari, where is the question of good qualities? They are just like a mirage in the desert, or they are just like a reflection of an apple. Like, if you have a mirror, and then you have a reflection of an apple, can you eat the reflection? You cannot. There is no substance to it. So they may be possessing all the good qualities superficially, but they do not have any value whatsoever. Because they are just driven by the time, place and circumstance. They do not have any local standing. Cannot stand. It doesn't have a foundation to stand on. So without a Krishna consciousness, there is no question of good qualities. And therefore, without having good qualities, how can we sustain marriage? So therefore, without having Krishna consciousness there, we can hope for more divorces.
not happening is a surprise. And somehow other, like, there is a pious element that is coming together because of which the divorce is not happening. Right? Then he says,
kind of, it's hard to, you know, grasp all that, but the thing is, there are people who are really good people, but again, they may not believe in Krishna.
So, when you say good people, it's circumstantially good. Right? It's their circumstances are making them exhibit certain qualities which you are terming them as good. Change the circumstance, which means you tilt the reflection. You can't even see the apple anymore. The apple does not even exist. At some point in time you saw, at a particular angle, you are able to at least see the apple. Although you cannot eat it. It's a superficial. But you tilt the mirror a little bit, there is no apple. Similarly, you change the circumstance, all this goodness will go out because he does not have a platform to stand on. And that's what happens. Like, marriages end up in divorce because it's like, it's the example is given also in Bhagavatam, that it's like different, when two living entities are coming together, it's like if you think of like weeds floating around in the ocean, right? With the currents, the weeds are coming together. So the two hearts seem to have like met together. Oh, you think like this, I also think like that. So it's perfect. Like, there's a perfect compatibility, and one starts thinking that way. And then, because the nature of the desires is such that it's just going to change, because you don't have a foundation. Say, one desire set will go in a particular direction, another set of desires will go in another particular direction, and they will diverge again. And when there is divergence, conflict. So, because of the particular current, they seem to be close at a particular time. And again, because of the same current, they will diverge. And when they diverge, there is divorce. So therefore, that's why the word that is used is manorathena. So without the foundation of Krishna consciousness, what is the basis? The basis becomes the mind. It's like one is riding on the chariot of the mind. And when one is riding on the chariot of the mind, one is completely at the mercy of the mind, wherever the mind takes. So there is no protection. Very, very dangerous, precarious position for any living entity to be in. So it's very, very important to have this strong foundation. Okay?
You know, I just want to sort of comment on your question. You know, they say in the West, don't judge a book by the cover. In every organization, I've come to many organizations, they're evil people everywhere, even in ISKCON, and outside ISKCON. So it's not that they're good people in one organization, that's false. They're good people outside ISKCON, they're wicked people in ISKCON, they're also good people in ISKCON. So don't be fooled. Just because someone dresses up like a devotee, it doesn't mean that he practices MMA. That is nonsense. I know temple presidents, I know people who've been cheated, are personally cheated. So not everyone is just, you know, don't judge the book by the cover. I'm just saying that you're just, you know, don't judge the book by the cover. There are good people everywhere, there are bad people everywhere. Okay? Don't be fooled by anyone. So be extremely careful and become pure, like he's saying, I agree with everything he's saying. You should yourself become pure, but don't be fooled, you know.
Thank you very much, Dr. Prabhupada.